Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyyihi wa mustafa Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah wa ba'd. I praise Allah the Almighty alone, and I send the best peace and blessings upon His most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, welcome to a new live edition of your program Ask Huda. A quick reminder with our phone numbers and contact informations in the beginning. The phone numbers with the area code 002-0238-555-248-249. And the email address is ask@huda.tv. And the Facebook page is www.facebook.com/msalahofficial. Without any further ado, I just have a few pending questions. Meanwhile, you can start ringing in, inshallah. The first question we got is from Brother Fahim from Sweden. He says that my uncle passed away, and now a man has come forward claiming that my uncle owed him a large amount of money. We cannot confirm this. What should we do? I do remember asking him whether he has any evidence that his uncle owed him that much money or not, and he said we cannot confirm this. It is very important for every person before meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make sure that he does not owe any person any money or any property. As a matter of fact, once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was invited to lead the funeral prayer for one of his companions who passed away, as he was ready to start the prayer, he asked if he owed anybody any money, and in fact he did. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Sallu ala sahibikum." He abstained from leading the funeral prayer for this person and said, "You go ahead and pray." So one of the companions said, "I will take care of settling his debt, Ya Rasulullah." And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not agree to lead the prayer unless he made sure that the debt was settled, or somebody have taken the responsibility of settling the debt. This is what's known as huququl ibad. And unfortunately, many people are very negligent of that, and they think it's an easy matter. If you die, that's it. By analogy, those who are living in the West, if they want to get away and write off any debt, they just simply file for bankruptcy, even though they may have some money somewhere saved, but it cannot be seen or uncovered by the authorities. In this case, these people have to understand that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refused to lead the funeral prayer because somebody, the dead person, owed some money and he did not settle it before his death. Also, it is very important to understand that the very first right before dividing the inheritance and fulfilling the wasiyah, number one is settling the debt. That if the person has a document that the dead person owed him any money. But if he doesn't, the family of the dead person are not required to pay this person anything because of the possibility maybe he's not telling the truth. It's a scam. And that happens, the dead person. And that's why it will be best if we follow the instruction of the Quran when it comes to doing business or lending or borrowing money. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the longest ayah in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا تَدَايَنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمًّا فَاكْتُبُوهُ بَيْنَكُمْ. This ayah is the longest ayah in the Quran pertaining the debt. What to do when you borrow money? Write it down. And have the shuhud, the witnesses. And the writer or the scribe must be an honest person. The ayah talks in details about that. I just don't have time to go through the ayah. Otherwise, this is the sunnah. We should do this, especially if the loan is a significant amount of money. So basically, you're not required to pay this guy anything because he doesn't show any reference, unless if you trust this man's deen and amanah, and he's known amongst his neighborhood and family, he's an honest person, and he swears, because al-mayyinatu ala al-mudda'i wal-yaminu ala man ankar. So basically, the defendant is dead, so we cannot ask him to swear. But if he, the person who's claiming to have the money or to lend the money to the dead person, failed to bring a proof that he lent him the amount of money, we'll go back to some circumstantial evidences. If he is known that he's an honest person, and if he swears that he gave him the money, then it would be better to pay him back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abu Abdul Aziz from Kuwait. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you, Shaykh?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. Thank you for asking. Barakallahu feek.
It's good to hear you again, Shaykh. I just have simple 3 questions.
Sure. Jazakallah khairan. Go ahead.
Shaykh, I wanted to ask you regarding a woman who is in menses.
Naam.
Is she allowed to enter Masjid al-Haram? Let's say if she's on Umrah. Can she enter Masjid al-Haram?
No, she's not allowed to enter any masjid nor Masjid al-Haram.
Okay, and the second question is, Sheikh, I just heard someone talking about it yesterday on TV saying that once during a battle, I'm not sure which battle, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he needed to use a bathroom. So there was nothing, there was no shades, there was no place where he can use. Go for his number to do number one. So by magic or by I should not say by magic. They were using some word that there were some tiny trees, and they started by itself. They start covering him so he can use.
Never heard of that.
Never heard of it.
No. Next question, please.
Yeah, but I was because whole night I was wondering. I never heard of it, so I said I should ask the Sheikh.
Mm. When we say al-khala, or going to the open place to answer the call of nature, anywhere which is open, even if there is no shade, it's desert. As long as you're not surrounded by people or people can see you. There are a lot of hills, little mounds, sandy areas. The person can do that. Okay? Jazakallahu khairan. So I guess now your 2 questions have been answered. Sister Fatima from the KSA, assalamu alaikum. Fatima, assalamu alaikum. Try again, Sister Fatima. I have a very interesting question from Abu Zaki from the KSA. He said, if a Muslim repents, will he still be held accountable in the hereafter for those sins which he repented from? Well, let's see what the Quran says in this regard. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about the traits of Ibad al-Rahman by the end of the surah. And he said, وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرَ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ هَلْقَ أَثَامًا. Yani whoever commits shirk, whoever kills unjustly, whoever commits adultery, يَلْقَ أَثَامَ shall receive a great sin and will be punished for that sin. What kind of punishment? يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَيَخْلُدَ فِيهِ مُهَانَ. The torment will be double for him on the day of judgment, and he shall abide therein with humiliation and disgrace. إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Except if the person who committed these grievous sins, including shirk, adultery, killing, drinking, you name it, all the major sins, if the person repented, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatened the sinners who committed those sins with this grievous punishment, he said, "Illa, except for those who repent, وآمنا, and believe, وعمل عملا صالحا." And that's why the scholars another condition for the validity of tawbah, which is to follow the evil deed with one which is good. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا, and follow the evil deed with one which is good, it shall erase it. وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. In the Quran, in Surah Hud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبَنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ ذَلِكَ ذِكْرَ لِلذَّاكِرِينَ. Verily, the good deeds erase the bad deeds. Well, وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ. For those people, such people who were big time sinners, then they repented sincerely and they started doing good righteous deeds, يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. Allah will exchange their bad deeds and their sins, the count and the number of their bad deeds will be good deeds instead. Replace the bad deeds with hasanat, with good deeds. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. And Allah is the all-forgiving, the most merciful. وَمَنْ تَابَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَإِنَّهُ يَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَتَابًا. So these are the conditions of tawbah. If the person fulfilled these conditions, regretted, and made a strong covenant not to go back to the same sin, and he quit, obviously, and he followed it with a good deed, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pardon him. Not only that, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace their bad deeds with ones which are good. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Ra'uf from Qatar.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I had two questions, Shaykh. My first question is about the prayer.
Yeah.
I have, the small electronic clock at home that makes azan, during the prayer time. So after that, let's say, if that clock works and the azan is pronounced, do I need to recite my own azan before prayer, or that azan is sufficient?
Okay, Jazakallahu khairan. Second question.
Last question. I have a small baby, the small 1.5 years old baby, and I know that when we are young, we need to, we need to cover our mouths, and should it also be applied for the baby when our baby is yawning? And the same Shaykh also about sneezing. When the child sneezes, should we as parents say Alhamdulillah on his behalf or not? Thank you very much. Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum. Barakallahu feekum. Okay, Brother Muhammad from Kuwait. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Muhammad, assalamu alaikum.
Hello.
Go ahead, listening. I can listen. I can hear you.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Salah. How are you?
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Proceed on, please.
Sheikh, I have two questions.
Yeah.
If a person is financially dependent on his children, is it right for him to marry as he is a dependent on his children and cannot support with his wife himself? That's my first question.
So he's already married, right?
Second, if a person is financially...
Muhammad, the person or the father is already married and his wife is still alive.
No, his first wife is expired.
Okay.
So he's marrying again.
Okay. And can his children afford to support him to get married?
And he's dependent on his children. Financially, probably cannot support himself.
Can his children afford that? That's my question.
Yeah.
Okay, then why not? أَنْتَ وَمَالُكَ لِأَبِيكَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you and what you own belong to your father, owned by your father. So if the mother expired and he is single and he is dependent entirely financially on his children and he wants to get married, his children should assist him to get married and support him financially. Why not? Mu'adh ibn Jabal, may Allah be pleased with him, and there was only a few days left in his life, Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, زَوْجُونِ لَا أَلْقَ اللَّهَ عَزَبًا. I want to get married. I don't want to die while I'm being a bachelor. Because marriage is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and maybe he's in need for somebody to assist him in his senility, to give him, to entertain him, to give him company. So if the children are capable, they should assist him in this regard. Second question, Muhammad. Muhammad, assalamu alaikum. Tayyip, try again. I hope you like the answer. Brother Rauf from Qatar had a couple of questions. At home, he has a digital clock. The adhan will go on whenever it is the prayer time. He says, am I required to call adhan? By the way, I just returned today from Doha, and I've seen a lot of masajid everywhere, mashallah, la quwata illa billah. Similarly, in Dubai, and I cannot imagine somebody who lives in a place where the masajid are so beautiful, they have imams with melodious voices, furnished very neatly, smell very great. Why don't you attend the prayer in the masjid? Somebody on the way who's driving me to the airport, he said, the masjid is 2 kilometers away from my house. Will you drive? You drive to get a drink, you drive to get the bread, to get the food. Why not? 2 kilometers is not a big deal. Drive back and forth, because it is 27 times greater to pray in the masjid than if you pray at home. So in this case, you wouldn't have to worry about calling adhan or iqamah because you pray jama'ah. In case that you are living in one of these compounds where there is no masajid or working in the field, if it is a jama'ah, then you should call adhan and call the iqamah. If you're praying by yourself, then you should only call the iqamah, not the adhan, whenever it is the prayer time. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if people were to know the privilege and the reward that lies in calling adhan and in praying the first line, they would compete to reserve such reward, even if they have to draw lots as who would be eligible to call adhan and who will get to pray in the first line. Brother Nizar from Qatar, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Do me a favor and mute your TV set, please, Brother Nizar. Now you can talk.
Actually, Sheikh, we were very happy that you were here and we were benefited for last 2 days. In Qatar.
Brother Nizar, Jazakallah khairan. Mute your TV, please. Mute your TV, Brother Nizar.
Okay, I mute already.
Okay, now, Jazakallah khairan. Actually, the pleasure was all mine. I enjoyed the visit so much.
Regarding... regarding Shahar, the black magic.
No.
Because here last time, I went to the bayan, and Sheikh said that this black magic is there, and even it was done to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So if it is like that, so during that Sihr period, so... So then, what about revelation?
Hi, I got your question. Thank you, Brother Nizar. Jazakallahu khairan. Naam. Naam. Brother Rauf's second question. Rauf from Qatar, his second question was, we know that in yawning you should cover your mouth. That is so because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whenever you yawn, you should cover your mouth, obviously, فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَدْخُلُ, because Satan would enter into your stomach or abdomen. He said, if a child yawns, should we cover his mouth, maybe by our hand? Yes, of course, because the same applies here. But when the child sneezes, should we say in his stead, Alhamdulillah, al-atas, or sneezing, the sunnah is to say, Alhamdulillah, whenever you sneeze, and at tashmeet, when the person hears you sneezing and then saying, Alhamdulillah, should say, Arhamukumullah, may Allah have mercy on you, and you should reply by saying, Yahdikumullah, uslih balakum, as you all know, the setup of these invocations. But if the child sneezes and he doesn't know how to say it, you don't have to. But if you're doing this as a mean of teaching the child, training him what to say, that is perfectly fine. Okay, barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Fatima from KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah, walaikum assalam. Sheikh, I had asked you a question in the last but one episode of Tuesday, which you said you will answer in the next episode, next Tuesday, for the reason that Sunday you were in Dubai conference. But I guess you misplaced my question, because I didn't get the answer in the episode also. Shall I repeat my question?
Please.
Yeah. The first question is, this was regarding my two madrasas, one Salafi madrasa and one Rami madrasa, which I'm sending my 11-year-old and 20-year-old boy and girl. So that you have not answered. I wanted to know which madrasa is better. They are going to Salafi madrasa. Now I doubt whether I should send them to Salafi or not. So I wanted to ask you whether World Association of Muslim
Youth. What is the other madrasa called?
World Association of Muslim Youth, WAMI.
Okay, WAMI.
This is the second question, Sheikh.
That is in Dubai, sister?
Pardon?
Both schools, where exactly are they located at?
In Saudi Arabia.
Oh,
in Dammam. Dammam, Saudi Arabia.
No.
Okay. My next question, Sheikh, shall I ask you?
No.
Yeah. This is about credit card. I use credit card, but I have never paid interest on it. I always pay before the due date. Now, the thing is, whenever we make a purchase on our credit card, we get points on it. Suppose I purchase 100 rupees item, I get 10 points on it. What I wanted to know was, can we redeem these points for gifts? The bank is saying we can redeem these points for gifts. So can we do this, or those gifts are haram? This is the second question.
Okay, jazakallah khair. As far as the schools, we need to do our homework and read the feedback, because here I have no access to know about this madrasa or that madrasa. For me to send my children to any school, myself and my wife, we read the feedback about both schools. We contact parents who have children in this school. We ask local people about the schools, about the curriculums. We pay a visit to the school, meet with the administrators, with the teachers, and know what kind of syllabus they teach. Check out the teachers. I took them to an Islamic school before, my children, and I saw the teachers, the ladies were wearing jeans and blouses and so on. This is supposedly an Islamic school. So I have to visualize and I have to see by myself in order to determine. The Sheikh wouldn't have an access to know, because this is called Salafi school or this is Wami school. It is not by the name. Okay? It's like a credit score. I have to go and check out these schools by myself, read about their feedback, consult parents who have their children in the school to find out. We're going to take a short break, and inshallah, we will be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
Have spilled over onto this,
escalated into violent clashes between police and protesters
over the government's plan to avoid default,
and we're also hearing of injuries on both.
Journalist Charlie McGrath says the cuts will heap further suffering on ordinary people
for decades, but the fence needs some
this is a serious and big storm.
Join me as I explore issues, pressing issues facing the Muslim world today. From the one-sided civil war in Syria to the genocide in Burma, from the Arab Spring to the elections in the U.S., and yes, even the Euro debt crisis in Greece. Honest reporting on a channel you can trust, and I won't leave an issue untouched. Don't miss the Ummah Tonight with me, Malik, on your favorite channel for the TV.
In a game of golf, both the caddy and the golfer have the same goal, to get the ball into the hole. Interest-free banking is similar. With a clear view of the fairway, a predefined agreement without shifting targets, things should end up where you want them. Your deposits are safe, and your funds are ethically managed with a transparent and equitable approach to sharing risk and reward. No interest burden means more time to relax without the worry of nasty surprises. Rest assured, our interest is mutual. Jazz Bank, Nigeria's first full-fledged non-interest bank.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Brother Nizar from Qatar said that you heard that magic is a fact and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam suffered from magic. Is this true? And what happened to him in the Sharia during the Wahi, during the time where he was under the magical spell? Number one, the hadith which indicates that the Prophet ﷺ suffered from a magical spell is a sound hadith. And it was for a whole month, and it affected him ﷺ, but it did not affect his da'wah and the wahi that he received. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects you and guards you from people. But for some reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed this to happen to inform us, number one, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a human being, also to warn us against sorcery and magic, and that those who deal with it are disbelievers, and those who seek sorcery or go to sorcerers and seek their help have committed the act of disbelief. It was the job of the Jews at this time, because the magical spell was cast on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by a Jew. Basically, there was a young man who was serving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Jew utilized him. He asked him to get the hair, the leftover hair, from the comb that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to dress his hair with. And he took this hair of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he made a magical spell of 12 knots, and he buried it somewhere in an abandoned well. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the two angels came and sat next to him, Jibreel alayhi salam and another angel, and informed him where exactly the magical spell was buried. And he sent Ali radiallahu anhu, and he dug it out, and he undid the magical spell. And the last two chapters of the Quran were revealed as the greatest means against the magical spells and the evil eye and so on. So, An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did suffer from this magical spell, as I mentioned, and he was able to fetch out the magical spell and undo it. And An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not affected when it comes to the da'wah or the wahi, because this is something that is guarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was not affected the least in this regard. Okay? Barakallah feek. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thani from Ukraine. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Can you hear me? Hello? Okay, if you can hear him, take the question. And you can just send it to me, inshallah, right now, I'll be able to collect it. Brother Ramzi from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaykh.
How are you, Shaykh? Alhamdulillah wa shukrillah.
Alhamdulillah, may Allah bless you.
And you too, barakallah feekum. Go ahead.
Shaykh, I have three questions I want to ask you.
Please.
The first question, I want to know the ruling on video games. Is it halal or haram, or... And my second question, is leaving the beard to grow a wajib wal a sunnah, as some people say?
To do what?
To leave your beard to grow.
Okay.
And my last question is, for the expiation of the oaths.
Mm.
If you, for example, broke two oaths, can you make the expiation, for example, you want to fast 3 days. Can you do them together or not?
Okay.
Yeah, and that's it.
Barakallah feekum.
Jazakallah.
وجزاكم brother Ramzi. Thank you so much. Sister Tauba from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Ask Huda. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Tauba. Okay. Unfortunately, I cannot hear you. Please try again. Brother Ramzi from United Arab Emirates. Her three questions. The first is pertaining to video games, halal or haram. It depends on the contents. And it depends when do you play the lawful video games. So video games, contents are halal, will motivate your intelligence and make you smart, or spend some lawful fun time, fine. But even if you're playing a halal video game, no music, no nudity, etc. And meanwhile, it distracts you from offering the prayer on time and from attending the prayer in the masjid and from your duties. Many kids, whenever they play the video game, they become blind, deaf, and dumb. The parents will scream, will call on them. They are in another world. This is where any game becomes haram. If the person is reading the Quran and is called upon by his parents, he should answer. If the person is doing anything other than the father prayer, and he's called upon by his parents, he should answer. But we have seen that many children, they get addicted to the video games, that it consumes most of their time, and when they get sucked in the game, this is a matter of life and death. So if they perceive it properly, it's a game. There is no money involved, no gambling involved. It doesn't consume your precious time. You just play it whenever you have some free time to change. Then, and the contents are halal, then it is halal. Whether growing the beard is sunnah or wajib, definitely it's a wajib. Definitely it is a wajib. All the scholars are of the view that the founders of the four schools of thoughts, that it's a wajib. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered in more than one hadith, in different words, growing the beard. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Awfiru liha," and he said, "Afu liha," "Awfiru," save your beards, and said, "Do not shave your beards while trim your mustaches." He said, "Khalifu al-mushrikeena," you gotta look different than the mushrikeen. And obviously, subhanallah, the beard of the Muslim, along with trimming the mustache, is very distinguishing. Only Muslims would look like that. When some people say, but the Jews still grow the beards, but they grow the beards on other things as well. Okay? But there is a setup in our Sharia that regulates which hair should be removed and which hair should be saved. So growing the beard is a wajib, and saving it is a wajib, and shaving it is a sin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us what's best. Sister Saida from Canada. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Can you raise your voice just a bit, sister?
Sheikh, I'd like to ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to know if it's permissible for someone to donate organs, let's say, you know, you write in your will, or you let your family members know, should you be in a fatal accident, if you can donate like your liver, your kidney. Mm. Also, if it's permissible to receive organs.
Okay. Jazakallahu khair. And thank you, Sister Saida. Barakallahu feek. And thank you for your feeling. Sister Tauba from the KSA is back on the line. Sister Tauba, assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, I have three questions.
Are you calling on the same line, Sister Tauba?
Sorry?
Are you calling on the same line that you called on earlier?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sheikh, my question is, I read in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari about Sajda Sahu, that if we have doubt in our prayer that we offer 3 or 4 rakah, we should do Sajda Sahu. But I want you to tell me the method of Sajda Sahu. And my second question is, can we offer prayer by wearing perfume, whether it has alcohol in it or not? And my third question...
No, I didn't get the second question. I'm sorry. If you please repeat it again.
Second question?
Mm-hmm.
Can we offer prayer by wearing perfume, whether it has alcohol in it or not?
Mm-hmm.
My third question is, I have some like decoration pieces in my home, like frog, bird. Is this allowed?
These are images or statues or what?
It's like not statues, kind of like a decoration pieces, small decoration pieces of like bird, frog.
These are like, you know, again, statues.
Yeah, it's that kind of statue.
Okay. Thank you so much. Barakallah fiqh. Sister Umma Abdul Rahman from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. I have two questions, Sheikh.
Please.
The first one is regarding drinking Zamzam water while standing and facing towards Qibla. Is it proved from any hadith?
Okay.
And the second question is, if a man marries for the second time while his first wife is alive with two kids or three kids, whatever, what is the Sharia ruling regarding the maintenance of the first wife and the children if they are unwilling to join the husband after the second marriage? Even in spite of the husband willing to take care of his first wife and children, but the first wife is unwilling to stay with the husband.
But she's willing to be a divorcee.
No, but she is asking for a security, like for her children.
What do you mean?
Islamically permitted. What is the Sharia ruling on this?
Okay, what kind of security you're talking about? Financial security, you mean?
Yes, financial. Because his first wife knows that the father-in-law is a wealthy person, so she wants property and financial security from the husband or from father-in-law, whatever.
So he wants him to write something for his first wife and for the children as a security, and in this case he will be okay with the second marriage, right?
Sorry, Sheikh, I didn't get you. Actually, the problem is the first wife is, she's not ready to stay with the husband, and she wants a solid security from the husband. That's it. Husband or father-in-law.
Okay. Sister Umma Abdul Rahman, the first wife, she doesn't want to stay with the husband if he were to marry again. Okay. Now, what kind of security she's asking for if she's asking for divorce? Because if she gets divorced, she would only be eligible for the nafaqa, the child support. But if she still remains as a wife, she has all the rights, as long as the husband is still alive, the nafaqa, the housing, spending, support. And if he died, then she has a share in the inheritance. But if she is divorced and the iddah is over, she would not have a penny in his inheritance, so she wouldn't have any security. What I'm trying to say is just to put the things in the right perspective. Maybe I can elaborate furthermore when answering your question. Do you have any other questions? Okay, thank you. Brother Ibrahim from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello?
Assalamu alaikum, Ibrahim.
Wa alaikum salam.
Okay, go ahead and say your question, please.
I have one question.
Go ahead, Ibrahim, I'm listening.
Sheikh.
Okay, thank you for your question. Barakallah feek. That's an easy one. Brother Ramzi's third question from United Arab Emirates. It says, if he has made more than one oath and he violated both, can he give one ransom, kafara, for the two? Of course not. If you made an oath on two different things, you made an oath not to go to this place, and you made an oath not to eat the thing, or not to talk to that person, or not to smoke again. Yani, I'm giving examples. Okay? You violated both. So each oath requires a ransom. لا يؤاخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم ولكن يؤاخذكم بما عقدتم الأيمان فكفارته then the kafara runs as follows. إطعام عشرة مساكين من أوسط ما تطعمون أهليكم أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة either feeding, clothing 10 مساكين or freeing a slave فمن لم يجد فصيام ثلاثة أيام if you cannot afford financially to feed or to buy clothes for 10 masakin, then fasting 3 days, they don't have to be consecutive, would be the prescribed ransom, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Here, for each oath, there is a kafara. This is different than when you said, Wallahi, I will not touch this mug. Then you made another oath to the same thing. Then the ransom for violation for violating these two oaths will be one because it was pertaining one act, whether to do or not to do. Barakallahu fikum. Sister Saida from Canada asked about organ donations. Organ donations. If it is mere donations and if it will benefit or save somebody else's life, definitely. And it is donations, it is permissible. This is one of the things which are known as contemporary fiqh issues. So, it undergoes different opinions and khilaf, whether the person is alive or dead. But nowadays we see that it saves a lot of lives. It saves the life of a dead person if he is, for instance, needed kidney transplant or liver transplant or even a heart. While somebody has died already and he allowed his organs to be donated afterward. So if that it would save somebody's life and it is donation, mere donation, not for a compensation, one of the very respected views, it says it is permissible. Can you receive? Yes, he can also receive because if he can donate, then it is allowed to receive. Wallahu a'lam. Khal from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Yeah.
Dr. Khan, assalamu alaikum.
Sheikh, I have a question.
Go ahead, Dr. Khan.
Regarding magic.
Naam?
It's regarding magic.
Okay.
Actually, we have come across one hadith, which is Sahih hadith from Bukhari Sharif. And it states that 70,000 people on Yawm al-Qiyamah will go to Jannah. These are the people who have not done ruqyah in life.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to know whether this hadith is to just, not to motivate people to go ahead with the treatment of magic in the form of ruqyah. Because I spoke to one sheikh here and he said that if you want to get, if you want to know that somebody has done magic and you want to get treated, then you have particular specific ayat in Quran which you have to read.
Mm.
And this is the treatment called ruqyah.
Now, by your question.
So in the light of this hadith, whether it is not motivated in Islam to go ahead with the treatment of ruqyah if somebody is suspecting magic done on him or her.
Now. The hadith was Dr. Khan is referring to is a sound hadith and is collected by Bukhari or Muslim. And the most sound one is in Al-Bukhari where it says that those 70,000 people who will enter Al-Jannah without reckoning, without hisab, they will not be questioned the least. The companions were puzzled and they kept guessing. So the Prophet ﷺ came upon them and said, such people will be Al-Ladina. لا يسترقون ولا يتطيرون وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. This is the most sound narration because there is another one which says لا يرقون ولا يسترقون وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. But لا يسترقون, they don't ask for رقية. They don't go and seek somebody to give them رقية. Why? Because they trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't ask for it. But here is one thing I want to tell you. Number one, it is not prohibited to ask somebody to give you ruqya. Rather, you would miss the privilege of being one of the 70,000 people. the whole hadith revolves around how much those people put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also because of the tatayur, bad omen. They don't believe in bad omen. Rather, they trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they put their trust only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So much so that nothing would affect them as long as they put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If somebody is because of the magic or whatever, and he wants to know, you don't have to go to another person to tell you. As a matter of fact, most of the myth and the mess that happens because you go to the wrong people, and right away they tell everybody that we are under magical spell, under magical spell, under magical spell. Everybody comes back and he is, you know, with the fear that he's under the magical spell and what to do. So they start going back and forth to the same people. If any person managed to read Surah Al-Baqarah entirely, then he's not under magical spell. Ash-Shaytan and the sorcerers cannot tolerate nor resist Surah Al-Baqarah. And this is in the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, recite Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنَّ أَخْذَهَا بَرَكَةً وَتَرْكَهَا حَصْرَةً وَلَا تَسْتَطِيعُهَا الْبَطَلَةً. Satans and sorcerers cannot afford nor resist the effect of Surah Al-Baqarah. Reciting Surah Al-Baqarah in one house keeps the shaitan away for 3 days. So if you happen to recite Surah Al-Baqarah on a regular basis, a word of magic and the evil eye and the effect of the shaitan, inshaAllah, Azza Jal. Barakallahu feek. Sister Tauba from the KSA asked about doubt in the prayer. Yes, there is a sound hadith when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to seize the doubt with certainty. If I started the prayer and I'm not sure, now how many rak'ahs did I pray? 3 or 4? And I'm undecided, then I should consider the lesser. 3 rak'ahs. I pray 1 extra and I pray sujood as-sahw by the end. Same applies to the number of rounds in the tawaf and the number of trips in as-sa'i. It happens almost to everybody because of the crowd and you get distracted. You're not sure you made 7 rounds or only 6. Okay, consider them 6. But if you're sure that you made them 7, you say, let me make 1 extra in case, that is wrong. If you're sure that you prayed 4, you say, maybe I have forgotten 1 rak'ah, you pray 1 extra, the whole prayer will be invalid in this case. Keeping those birds and animals, statues at home, undergo the warning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they will ward off angels from entering your house. Keep the angels out of your house and they will invite ash-shayateen, even for decorations. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not say only if you were taking them in worship or worshiping them. No, he said no. لا تدخل الملائكة بيتا فيه كلب ولا صورة ولا. And the angels would not enter a house in which there is a dog, there is a statue or an image of a living, a picture of a living being, an animal or a human being. We ran out of time. So inshallah next time we'll begin by answering Umm Abdul Rahman and the sister's question pertaining the credit card and the points. Until then, brothers and sisters, make dua for the whole ummah. Make dua for your brothers and sisters in Burma, in Myanmar. May Allah give them victory and may Allah defeat their oppressors. May Allah take revenge from their oppressors. May Allah feed our brothers and sisters in Syria and give them security and enable them to get rid of their dictator. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hada wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the altar.